This is what I'm saying, bruv. It's just I'm an anomaly in this situation because there's a lot of stuff that people don't know about me for obvious for my own reasons, to be honest, because I haven't really.
Welcome back to another lockdown edition episode of Shotgun the Orcs podcast. It's Tom coming live from isolation. But for the record, it's not actually live. Without further ado, we've got another very special guest for the podcast today. He's been in the game longer than Bruce Forsyth. It's man like Bailey's Brown. How are you doing, brother?
Yeah, big up, bruv. It's good to be here, man. It's good to finally connect.
Yeah, man. And we were just saying, weren't we? Like, we meant to link some time ago. We were going to come up to Bristol to film a few of these, but obviously the pandemic kind of swept the globe and it didn't end up happening, but it's good that we could link over Skype, man. You know, most of the technology available. What have you been up to during lockdown to keep yourself sane and occupied?
You know, like obviously I got a load of work that I'm finishing when it comes to music. I'm literally just bouncing stems now.
Nice.
Flipping, other than that, trying to keep on top of stuff in the house, isn't it? Like, it's nothing you can do other than just keep it moving, isn't it?
Exactly, man. So are you based in Bristol at the moment?
Yeah. Been here for about 14 years.
It's crazy, man. Where are you from originally?
Like, originally, I was born in South London. Moved to South Wales when I was 11. And moved to Bournemouth when I was...
Bournemouth?
I think, yeah. I went. Do you know Porchester Boys School? I don't know if it's even that called that anymore, but like, I went to Porchester. Yeah,
did you?
Yeah.
That's crazy, yeah. Man. I live in Winton. So I'm like...
Okay. Did you go Winton Boys then?
No. Yeah. I moved from Poole, so it's like the next town along. Yeah. But no, that's small world, man. Small world.
Yeah, a few boys from my school were from West Howe, isn't it?
Yeah, you know it well then.
Infamous West Howe.
That's just down the
road from here,
isn't it?
Yeah, man. Yeah, I lived in Pokestown, isn't it? Like, literally just behind the train station.
Yeah, man. So that's like Pokestown train station. You got Southbourne next to it. But you've got, you get some pretty good like hip-hop nights on in Boscombe occasionally, do you know what I mean? But
yeah. Well, I moved from there probably when I was like 16. And I was in Cardiff then, and then moved to Bristol when I was 19. I've been here since I was 19. Yeah.
Yeah, nice one, man. And was there any like particular reason why you
moved around so much? Oh no. You know what?
Creative scene or?
Well, you know what? I came to Bristol originally to go uni to do graphic design. I'd say the music side of things is kind of what led my life from there, because when I came to Bristol, I kind of dropped out of uni.
Yeah.
I'm focused on the music side of things. So I didn't even produce back then when I was 19. Started when I was 20. And then sort of took it a bit more serious from sort of 24, like, you know what I mean? Tried to start progressing from just making loops. But yeah, basically fell in love with the vibe of Bristol in general, not just the music scene, do you know what I mean? Like, it was quite a different place. Like, even in terms of, you know, any other city in a country, is just something different here. A similar vibe in Brighton, if I'm going to be honest, yeah, but like it's not the same. Brighton's not quite the same, innit? It's similar.
Bristol on the seaside, innit, kind of thing.
That's what I'm saying. There's that freshness, the sea air. Bristol's a bit grittier, you know what I mean?
But, I guess it's like the counterculture is quite ripe, innit, with like graffiti, with music, with fashion, all that kind of stuff.
And there's a lot more Caribbean influence here as well. Do you know what I mean? There's a lot more, like, you know, St. Paul's has birthed some of the most like important people in British music. Like, and regardless of Bristol, like it's like St. Paul's. You know, like the movements like Massive Attack, Portishead.
Portishead are a big one, aren't they, man?
Ronnie Size. Even to more recent people, you know, that in terms of Joker, Red Light, like all of these people came through, like, if I'm going to be totally honest, the St. Paul's music scene, like, because the reality is, especially back in them days, you couldn't just be anyone and play in at Lakota. Like, these like Bristol's club scene was obviously things have changed now because of gentrification, same as in every large city. Yeah, but Bristol's club scene was the training ground, and the streets was what came before it, in terms of like before you got anywhere near that stage, you were ciphering with people outside of like open mic nights and stuff. About 30 man there, and they're all rappers waiting to rap. So you kind of had to, you know what I mean? Like, and
yeah.
That's kind of like, it's something that I think that a lot of people don't speak about enough. Like, and maybe it's because there's not enough of maybe people of my age and my generation that get the opportunity to speak on platforms like this, maybe.
Yeah, man. Obviously rewinding things back a bit, when you first started kind of getting into making music, kind of the grassroots movement and stuff. So what was the initial things you started getting involved with? It was kind of the rave stuff, right? Before you got into hip hop and boom bap and stuff.
Yeah, I mean, like I've always been into music, you know, like obviously in terms of listening to music and being a fan of music. Before I even started making music or even rapping, yeah, I was a raver. Like garage was my thing. Like I'd go around the country to all the big raves, like, do you know what I mean? Like and that was my introduction to music as a fan, in terms of something that you're fanatic about and you go out of your way to seek out and all the rest of it. As far as hip hop's concerned, a lot of it came to me because obviously growing up in the 90s, that's what the thing was. So like each one of your friends either had something from here or something from there, and you got to pick and choose what was what, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah, man, 100%. I mean, it's kind of, I was talking to Juggernaut on the podcast, he was on earlier this week, about kind of coming into music through kind of hip hop, and then having, obviously people come into hip hop through appreciation of other genres. But he said he started to appreciate other genres through hip hop. Do you know what I mean? Because you hear kind of the completed package of it being repurposed, and then you start to think, where did I?
You know the maddest thing for me is it's the opposite way around for me, right? Because obviously I grew up in a house where like my dad's a Rasta, yeah.
Yeah.
And my mum is a big sort of like fan of soul music and R&B, but from, you know, the 70s and 80s. Yeah. So like when I was growing up, when I was little, I just had all the most dope shit being played in my house at all times.
Yeah.
So like when I was hearing hip hop growing up from say 95 to 2005, X amount of the samples I'm hearing, I know what they were.
and it is
dope. Like, and obviously then getting into hip-hop made me maybe sort of then appreciate, like he's saying, other genres that I wouldn't have been aware of, like prog rock, jazz, even like soundtrack stuff, like suspense, you know what I'm saying? Just
100%, man. So I'm guessing, as being a producer, you have kind of a keen ear for samples and stuff like that. And throughout your music, you've used some really kind of interesting and quite abstract and quite obscure samples, especially in the new joint you just dropped under like Axel Holy, which is your rap alter ego, Wonderworld.
Yeah.
Where did you find that sample, man? Because it was proper left field. I'm really
wait, what the beginning bit?
Yeah.
You know, right.
Crazy.
This is the thing, right? Basically, the album is called Wonderworld because, like, basically, I came up with my rap alter ego Axel Holy ages ago when I was doing Deadweight. Right.
Mm-hmm.
Which is me and Blanca from Split Profits, who is now Bubonic or 009. Yeah, hella names. But me and him, Deadweight. And that's how Axel Holy was born. Right. So that's a play on Axel Foley from Beverly Hills Cop.
Yeah, man.
And I was discussing doing, like, I'd been working on the album for a couple of years. Like, this is the thing. I started this maybe like a year and a half, 2 years ago. Obviously running alongside us, making stuff for everybody else. But like, I got towards the end of it and I was trying to sort of think of how to tie it all up. And Wishmaster says to me, he's like, yo, you know, there's like the fairground in Beverly Hills Cop 3 is called Wonderworld. And I was like, bang, that's the name of the album. Man. Went and got the film and then just went through the film for the clips. And the, have I sent you out the album?
Not yet, man.
Okay, I'll send you the press copy, yeah?
But, so by the time this drops, I would have heard it, man. I would have heard it and I'll give that a spin.
Yeah. So basically, that sample at the beginning is the theme tune from the fairground at the in this film, and I've just obviously mashed it up and give it a little whatever, you know.
That's cool, man. Now it's all like thematic and it all ties together. Like on Spotify, I check, 'cause it's just called intro, isn't it? And it's like obviously Eddie Murphy's character in the back. And it's kind of, man. I like that. It's so kind of niche.
Well, this is it. Like, I haven't ever released a solo project as a rapper before. So I thought like I want to do something that introduces the character that, you know, the alter ego as the rapper in a packet. Like it all makes sense and it's just a dope piece of art. Like, you know,
because I guess still fresh, like your debut LP that dropped last year. That was kind of.
It's not a debut though.
It's kind of not well.
In terms of what though?
In terms of a solo debut.
Baby's Brown.
Because you've done stuff with that kid and stuff like joint projects with people.
But I did an album called Eyes Speak Louder Than Words, which I dropped a year after I dropped Home by Eight. I got Dyke on there. I got Leaf on there. I got Bad Bones on there. This is what I'm saying, bruv. It's just I'm an anomaly in this situation because there's a lot of stuff that people don't know about me for my own reasons, to be honest, because I haven't really, up until say maybe last year, well, the last couple of years, I haven't pushed myself out there in the way that a lot of other people have, I guess.
Because I'm familiar with that project. I just didn't realise it was a kind of an album, an LP per se, because you've got the point I was getting to with the Still Fresh stuff is because you have like Axel Holy, like reference throughout the track list, you know what I mean? As in,
he raps on the project.
Yeah.
So you're talking about because I don't call Still Fresh an Axel Holy project. He just features.
This is
on
what I mean, man. Yeah.
X like, amount of yeah. yeah. It's a Baby's
Brown
project.
He's on most of them.
He's on a lot of the tunes. He's a lot. Yeah. Well, that was me just drip feeding everyone what was coming, because. Like I'm saying to you, like a couple of years ago, I realized that there's worth in being calculated in the stuff you're doing. So as well as him, as Axel being featured heavily on that album, in the next year or so, you're going to see him featured heavily on a lot of the people who I work with's albums, but not stuff that I've produced.
I see. Man. So kind of differentiating between two. Pretty
yeah, Baby's Brown. Baby Brown's entity. Over there.
No, I completely get that, man.
Yeah, Baby's Brown's had a lot longer in the game. Yeah, mm-hmm. So like, you know, whereas Axel is a new kind of thing. I don't want it to be a thing where, you know, like, nah, it doesn't matter. But basically, yeah, they're separate entities. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, I mean, I think a lot of kind of artists have had like alter egos in the past for kind of, it gives you kind of a license to do different things creatively, do you know what I mean?
Yeah.
So I really rate that, man. And I'm hoping, I mean, what I've heard so far is just trippy. It's like a melting pot of different things together. Do you know what I mean? It's like it's very kind of progressive. And I've read various like interviews that you've done and, you know, kind of trying to move away from that traditional boom bap sound, not kind of, I guess, intentionally because you don't like it, but because you're just a bit more kind of forward thinking in that sense.
This is kind of the thinking in, you know, separating Baby's Brown from Axel Holy. Solely because like I got a load of boom bap stuff coming out soon as Baby's Brown, because I still make boom bap. I still love making boom bap, but as a rapper, and as you know, just as a person and a fan of music, there's only X amount of boom bap that I listen to regularly, where there's a lot more of everything else. So there's a lot more of everything else coming into the influence of the production for me as a rapper, because I feel like it's more of an expression of who I am rather than a genre.
Yeah, I hear that, man. I hear that. So when, like, Still Fresh dropped last year, I mean, it came out on, like, Potent Funk, which I think is a very kind of, like, a good... It's a great label for you to drop that on. I think it just complements it really well in terms of the project it was. It's, like, very kind of laced with very, like, eclectic instrumentals. The whole thing is kind of very, like, diverse and an interesting sounding, do you know what I mean? And it's it kind of showcases not only your versatility as a producer, but it gives, like, a really interesting sonic landscape for all the MCs and singers on there to kind of, you know, bless the beats and stuff. Do you know what I mean? And the select kind of features you had on that album, do you have like some kind of process for who you feature and who you like to work with? Or is it just like,
to be honest, based on
connection or what?
Some of them, like the maddest thing is obviously some of them tracks weren't even meant for that album. Like that album came about because a few things, like basically, you see Horse's Mouth and Swim, the two boom bappy tunes that's on there, they were meant to be on Datty's album, Teeth Ledger, but they didn't end up getting finished in time. So I put them on my album. And there's a couple that was meant to be on my I basically a few tunes on that. That's why, right. You're smart, innit? Basically, the tunes with me on there, yeah, the tunes with Axel on there was meant to be for my debut solo rap album, innit?
Yeah.
But then I kind of lost steam halfway through it and the sound was changing. I was like, you know what? I need to just put this to one side. And then it all came together as a project when I started making new stuff. So I thought, you know what? It's not an Axel thing anymore. It's a thingy thing. But as far as... you know, the people that I work with, obviously a lot of the time it's my friends. Obviously the rappers that I've worked with for years, or and even the vocalists on there is collectives. It's from collectives that I work with in other ways, like basically Bogues off of About You. He's part of a group called Jabu. Like it's a experimental sort of R&B soul shit, really dope, interesting shit. But they're from a collective called Young Echo, and they gave Deadweight their first show, and we've been fucking with them for ages.
Like, oh, that's good, man. It happened organically then.
Yeah. Pretty much all of it. Like, you know, like I got a feature from Jugs on there, and to be honest, it's even older. It's so old. It's really, really old. He did it ages ago because I think I got the feature off of him maybe like a month after he did the, I can't remember whether it was a 16 bar or 32 bar challenge that we was all doing at the time. It's fucking ages ago, but like both of us popped off, but he wasn't really, I'd never really heard of him then. And I was like, yo, this guy's ill.
Yeah,
he's leveraged, isn't he, man? Yeah, this is what I'm saying, bro. He's dope. He's a really dope rapper.
Really, really really fucking safe guy as well, man.
Like, I can imagine. He looks like it. He looks safe. But I've never met him. Do you see what I'm saying? We've never, ever met. It's just been correspondence in them terms. And obviously, whenever I see him doing something that I like,
he's proper kind of humble, friendly, and real charismatic. Do you know what I mean? He's like... Yeah. Just a good guy, man. Like good vibe from him. Obviously, only met him like through Skype and stuff. But yeah, he was real talkative, chatty, just humble being the main thing. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah, of course.
And it's cool. It's like refreshing when you see that from someone so talented as well.
100%, man.
You know. But yeah, man. There were so many like sick tracks on there, and also like the visual content that came from that album as well. Like Gimme with Dabler, and you guys did a little competition off the back of that, didn't you?
Yeah, we did. Yeah, the remix competition.
Yeah. How did that come about? I mean, obviously, is that something that you've done before? Because generated some hype, didn't it?
Yeah, no, it's not nothing that I've ever done before, man. Like that was a Dabler thing. To be honest, I hadn't really utilized Brap before. So that was all new to me. So it was a very new thing But it was cool, man. I enjoyed it. There was a lot of good entries, few ropey ones.
But it's still good, like, for unity, isn't it? Like, just seeing what people
100%,
got,
bro. Good community 100%, vibe, man. 100%, like that. Like that's the one thing. Obviously, like I'd say, in a weird way, like hip hop kind of has. Obviously, in a weird way, it doesn't, because no matter what, there's always going to be a level of competition. And no matter how humble someone is or whatever, regardless of that, in order to be an MC and say the things you say, you're not that humble. It's fine. Yeah, it's fine to not be a dickhead in real life. That's absolutely fine. Yeah. But like, your inner being is an animal. You're a tiger. You're a lion. Yeah, that's the reality.
It's like a contradiction, isn't it? You know what I mean?
Yeah.
But that's just part of it, I guess. Like,
it's dope. It's dope. Because you see people struggling with it, isn't it? Like, exactly, bro.
It's a competitive sport.
People struggle with it nowadays because, you know, there's a lot more, people think there's a lot more to it nowadays, like, rather than, yo, it's still just hip hop. It's still just rap. It's still exactly what it was in the beginning.
I think like social media and that, and the kind of anxiety it brings with it, it plays a part in that as well. Do you know what I mean? It's kind of am I going to be like everyone's mate, or like, do I want to just be the best MC?
I think you should just be mates with people that you're actually mates with.
Yeah,
like,
that's
absolutely fine. Like, as long as you're not being a prick to people that you're not friends with, nothing else matters, innit? Like, as long as you're carrying yourself with a certain level of
integrity.
Word? Integrity, bro. That's it. Other than that, I don't mind people jumping on social media and gassing the tune that they just did that I haven't heard yet. If they just made it and they're feeling themselves, feel yourself, brother. Exactly, I like that, man. I like that energy. I like that confidence, especially within the UK hip hop scene. Car, we've been looked at as like some dusty guys for flipping ages. Whereas nowadays, I feel like we're kind of being taken a bit more seriously from outside of the UK hip hop circles. And that's literally down to one point, maybe a bit more coverage for certain of the bigger acts.
Yeah.
But also a diversity in what men are actually trying to do and trying to represent and trying to say.
Yeah.
So it's dope.
100%, man. I think that's a really good point. So you get kind of the more like flagship labels in the UK, you know that it's kind of sending a statement when they've got artists and they're like signing artists who are a little bit more kind
different.
Different, you know, it's not just boom bap, it's branching out. Yeah. And that kind of creates sustainability, doesn't it?
It's you know what done. It is? Like a few things changed in the world rap scene, like maybe like a good 5, 6, 7 years ago. You know, things like Run the Jewels happened.
Yeah.
Two heavily respected like underground MCs,
Dungeon Family and like Company Flow, man, just coming together in their 40s and shit. It's just like,
but doing something forward thinking,
yeah,
in their big ages, doing something forward thinking and it working like differently. Inspirational, Rev.
Yeah, man, 100%, man. I hear that. I think it's do you think as well, you know, like the term like UK hip hop is kind of is limiting to a certain degree. Because it's just hip hop, do you know what I mean?
Thinking a bit bigger. To be honest, I completely agree, and I just use that term then just to kind of make my point over what we are seeing as anyway. Car, you know, it's all good us changing our mindsets about what we are, but if like the outlets that do other things don't start to feel that way, then it is that, isn't it? But like, yeah, I agree. I feel like saying UK hip hop is whack. Like, just really hip hop or rap. Like, it's them things really. And even rap, it just should just be all hip hop because it's all come from that.
Yeah.
Unless it's specifically not, and if it's specifically grime or if it's specifically drill or dubstep, you know what I'm saying? But the
timeless artists I find are the ones who've kind of like dabbled in different sounds, you know, like Kanye and like Outkast and people like that, and you kind of feel damn, bro, they Outkast like constantly evolve from like project to project to project, And even, all of their stuff is timeless. All of it, man.
Yeah, definitely.
Even the fucking Idlewild album was kind of like, I revisited that, and that when it came out, it was a little bit like lost in everything else they'd done previously because it was a soundtrack. But I went back to it and I was like, man, there's some really, really like, really dope content on it. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah.
And I think it's those kind of artists when they don't, I guess, like compromise their like creative integrity and they're staying true to what they're doing, but try something else. They're the ones who really kind of stand out and progress. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah, man. Yeah, man. And I, because this is the one thing that kind of made me like, I'll be honest, like after Home by Eight and I Speak Louder Than Words, God knows how long ago, yeah, I started to hit a wall and I was really bored of just making boom bap loops, and not because I didn't love the music anymore, but as a producer I wasn't feeling challenged.
Yeah.
So I started trying to do new stuff and I started working with new producers and people that could show me different things, like, because I just wanted to progress, and naturally then I'm able to do more without having to get other people involved in terms of, do you know what I'm saying? Like,
yeah,
so
you've got more like creative like freedom to do it.
Yeah.
Yeah, who were we having this conversation with recently? I can't remember, but it was basically saying that same thing. It was like, because say if you're like penning bars to your own beats as well, yeah, and then it's if you were to say relying on someone else to produce or doing something for you, maybe that moment would be lost, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
The time that you send something across and those bars would be right at that time, but then when it comes back, you're like, oh, I'm not really feeling it anymore. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah.
So having that creative freedom to kind of do everything as one package, I think, must be quite liberating as an artist, you know what I mean?
Definitely, man. Like, I've grown up listening to all types of music. I've wanted to be able to make all types of music. And so, you know, once I knew a bit more, and once I was able to just step out of what I thought I was, then... yeah, that was it for me.
Sky's the limit, man. Exactly.
Yeah, man. Like, still, like I'm saying, like, there's still so much more to learn and so much more to do. There's like, even there's certain elements of music that I want to make, and I know artists I can do stuff with, and it's just a case of time and all the rest of it. So
yeah. You're in the right place in Bristol as well, man. You got like
a lot of when you hear my album, yeah, there's a vocalist on there that I've worked with before, yeah, but she smacked it, and I'm producing an R&B project for her at the moment, where nice. I'm obviously not rapping on none of it, but like
that's sick, man. And who was the other vocalist? Jordan Nathaniel.
He's just dropped a project, actually. I don't know if they've dropped the whole project, but I'm pretty sure they did, maybe like a few months ago or 2 months ago. But yeah, he's dope. He's really dope.
Is he Bristol based as well?
Yeah, he is. Yeah, yeah. He's from Leeds originally, but like, he's Bristol based, man.
That's crazy, man. But I mean, like, what's the most kind of obscure thing that you've ever sampled? Would you say? Too many to say.
Yeah, bruv, honestly, like, there's a load of stuff on the Deadweight stuff that's super weird.
Because it's very like, the whole aesthetic of Deadweight, like the videos and everything, is very like grimy, like kind of like negatives and
yeah,
all that
well,
stuff.
The original album that we did, we sampled all from 90s horror movie trailers. The soundtrack. We just took stuff from the trailers so that we got screams and weird stabs and footsteps. You know what I mean? That's the whole project. Like, and then,
are you a fan of horror films?
Yeah, like, I like them. I mean, there's bare shit that, like, I like things like, you know, the series that they did of Hannibal. Yeah.
Yeah, man.
Like, stuff like that, really dark, but like,
underappreciated,
dark.
Man.
Yeah. I like that. Woo!
They cancelled it, didn't they? Because, like, not enough people were watching it. It's just like, one of the best shows on TV, and, like, no one's watching it.
Low key satanic as fuck, but.
Exactly.
But it was dope. It was dope. Like, but, like I'm saying, there's that, and then there's other stuff, like, on some of the stuff where I've literally sampled myself. Like, I've sung some stuff into the computer, pitched it up, and then run it through some stuff and put it back into the track, and it just sounds like a female vocal sample and that. I create some of the riffs in some of the tunes on Still Fresh. Like, I think the tune me and Juggs did, there's a couple riffs that I've sung the riffs and then manipulated my voice so it sounds like a synth. I'll sample anything, bro. Like, I'll sample 80s flipping pop R&B-esque type shit, like Luther Vandross.
Yeah.
Anything that I think I can work with, man. Like, weird percussion loops that are tuned to make an actual, you know, melody out of, like, whatever. Like, I tried to move away from looping shit, like, a long time ago, just simply because the more I make music, I feel like if ever anything pops, I don't want to get pulled for clearance. I want them to work to get that. Yeah,
man. What do you think of the show Rhythm Roulette on YouTube? Because I hear mixed things, like mixed opinions about it.
To be honest, it's like I used to watch it back in the day. Like, I used to watch it back in the day, and my low key, we tried to make a show like that ourselves and all that. I mean, it's back in the day, I think it was cool. I just don't know if it really. I don't think the format really. Do you mean in terms of like samples and
just in terms of the format and just as a show? Like, yeah, the I don't concept think it, behind it.
The concept behind it's dope, yeah, but I don't think the format is right. I think you need to adjust the format for today's climate, which isn't like I've had this discussion already with someone. I'm not gonna divulge too much of my ideas, yeah, because I know there's other people with the same ideas and. We ain't friends, so
fair one, man.
You know what I mean? Like, but it's IP, bro. It's 2020. IP is a big thing.
I think it was because you know, one of the kind of opinions like against the show is that it's kind of revealing what they're doing and their tricks and stuff like that. It's like, what's your kind of view on that kind of thing? Do you have a process or any like? You know,
like
tricks of the trade, any secrets and stuff that you wouldn't divulge to people when you're sampling or
not at all. You know, the maddest thing, I've already shot one of these for what's his name? Leaf's little brother, Eric the Red.
Yeah.
Him and them man were doing a little series. I don't know if it ever came out, I can't remember. But like I flipped something on the MPC. And then bounce the stems into the computer, and then obviously I flipped it in front of them, blah blah blah.
Yeah,
they filmed it, and then they was about to pack down their computer like I'd finished. I was like, no, that's just stage one, bruv. Like, what do you mean? that would have been the whole beat back in 2010 or 2012 or whatever. Like, but today, like, there's hella shit going on. I personally, I think that's maybe what maybe limited, because I never went uni or college to study any of this shit, yeah? So, like, people that did get everything that you get in a Rhythm Roulette naturally, because you're in classes, but you're also in classes with a load of other producers. So you've got friends in your class that are like, yeah, but nah, I do it like this. You see what I'm saying?
Yeah, I hear you, man.
So man had a good like 3 to 4 years of that in your life.
Yeah, I hear you.
Yeah. So like to people that haven't had that, Rhythm Roulette is dope because you're not gonna know about certain plugins or
I guess it just kind of it scrapes the surface, doesn't it? So it's just more like I see what you mean, man. It doesn't kind of go into the kind of in depth.
Yeah, and I think, as well as that, I think it's good for producers that, because, like, this is the other thing, there's a lot of producers out there, like I say, that have projects out that probably were quite prevalent that people don't even know about because they don't put themselves out there in that kind of way.
Mm-hmm.
Like I'm saying to you with the eyes speak louder than words. Yeah.
Going full circle with this shit.
Because, like, it's mad. Because I did an interview with DJ Shorty last year for the Still Fresh thing.
Yeah.
And it was the same thing with him. Like, I don't even think he'd have heard of Home by Eight, bruv. That is what I'm saying.
No, man. I mean, that's kind of an underground classic now, man.
Well, this is what I'm saying. I've had to come to terms with that. That simply is the facts. Like, regardless of whether the fact that the one video for that thing has got a million views.
Yeah.
That album is super underground because it came out before this streaming era where, you know.
But it's like, you know, Demo Rust stuff from like 10 years ago or like even longer than that. It's like, like the Gotham shit that you did.
Yeah. Okay. Gotham Chronicles, man. I understand why no one knows that. That's like proper street level shit. Like we burnt that on CDs. Come on. Like this. I found this. Basically, this says, Henny 2011, right? What that is, obviously I'm dropping this Axel Holy album now. Back in these days, I used to go by the name of Descriptive or D Green, yeah?
Yeah.
And I've got a whole album that I did produced by my brethren, Chris Lucas, who does videos for all of us and Split Profits and all their man, yeah?
He did the Horse's Mouth video, didn't he?
Yeah. And he's produced this, did all the beats for me, produced this, yeah? 15 tracks, got Daddy on there, blah blah blah. I got a track with Kalashnikov on it.
Yeah, man. I was gonna say, like Kalash. You I haven't heard it, man. But
this album's not out. That's why.
You got to put that out. You got to do it.
Well, this is the plan. This is coming out. It is going to come out because we've actually had it mixed and mastered now, and it's sounding really good. And we got a load. The maddest thing is, Chris has still got like video footage that we shot back then on like some mad DV VHS cam. So we got a load of videos that we can make for it, and we're probably gonna make a little documentary to go with it because we got a load of footage from back, you know what I mean, just tie it all together as a thing, just to be like boom. It's also got like a Bristol rap legend on it, Surplus, prayers and wishes to him, like he's currently in a coma. No, prayers to his family and all of that. Yeah,
100%, man, 100%. But that's a good, not obviously the tragic news about your friends, but what you were saying about packaging things together, it's a good segue for my next point. Do you think as like an independent artist, it's kind of it's how kind of significant and important would you say it was to package your music? You know, like the hard copies, like collectibles, visual media. All at once, rather than kind of like drip feeding bits and bobs, and because everything's very like instantaneous and singles generation playlists these days.
Right. This is the thing of what I would say in terms of because things are the way they are. I don't think people should make music in that way. You shouldn't be approaching making music like this is going to be gone tomorrow, but you should be aware of it. Like you'd be aware that that people are just going to take their favorite tunes from your song and add it to their playlist and keep it pushing. Yeah, that's what I do with people's music. So I'm not expecting other people not to do that. That's absolutely fine. But in doing that, you've got to make the whole thing and process special. Do you know what I'm saying? A thing. Like that's the dope thing what Griselda have done. Like they've released 58 flipping thousand albums in such a short space of time. Tell me they haven't repeated a bar. You can't tell me they haven't. But because each release is a special thing, it don't matter, bruv.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I'm saying? Because there's a consistent level of quality, whether it be the production, whether it be the character, because that's the other thing.
Virgil Abloh on the fucking artwork, for fuck's sake. Do you know what I mean? It's just
controversial in my eyes, like because he kind of went a bit Raul style. That's a little bit controversial in my eyes. Yeah, I feel like Raul should have been brought in some kind of way because in my eyes, he's part of building what they have. Because he's been part of the aesthetic from day one.
Yeah.
Like, and he's the aesthetic that caught my eye. Like, the first tune.
It's like luxurious, isn't it? It's very,
It's complex simplicity, bro. Like, you can't teach it. You either got it or you don't. Yeah. If you can do something that to the naked eye seems so. I don't get why it works, but it's fucking dope. Yeah, that's what complex simplicity is, man. And
what,
like,
what, you, from a UK perspective, what do you think of like the Fly Hooligan? Because he's done some shit with those guys, isn't he?
What in terms of as a like? Because is the Fly Hooligan is that what's his name from Triple? What they called?
He was Iron Braids, like
yeah. So is that him? It's, yeah, it's not him and Parky together.
No, just him.
Okay. Yeah, no, he's dope, Rev. He's dope. Yeah. That tune, like, he's got some tune with my boy Dead. Well, he's got a few tunes with my boy Dead. Dead TBRC, but like he's dope, bro. Like I really rate like what he does from long yeah, time man. Ago. That visuals, fuck, aesthetics.
Yeah, that Fuck Your Life, Praise Mine 2 that dropped last year was sick, man. Yeah, and had like Planet Asia on it, and it was just like, yeah, it's crazy. But that same kind of like luxurious aesthetic, you know,
yeah,
you say
yeah,
but like the UK version of that. And he's done a track with like West Side Gun and stuff.
Yeah.
But those boys, yeah, Griselda's smashing it, man. I think like
just bro, they brought it like between them, yeah, and Freddie Gibbs and Madlib, because like that album had a big impact as well on the culture.
Pinata
man.
Or yeah, Bandana. Yeah. Bandana.
Yeah, because that went, because obviously the one before, we all know about that, yeah. But yeah. What I'm saying is this one, because obviously, you know, like how we've all known about Griselda for time, yeah. But like Griselda now is like,
you know, shady records kind of.
There you go. And like with the last Madlib and Freddie Gibbs album, they did that with that one album in it, because I think they had like one of them partnership deals with Warner. Yeah. They got that major label energy behind it, and it was received well, Grammy nominated, bro. Like that's a big look, man.
That Bandana record was sick, man. I went to see them live in London last year, and fucking Freddie Gibbs' stage presence is like nothing else, man. It's just kind of like, he's up there, you know, he's like Dolomite up there, do you know what I mean? He's so charismatic, and he's just like coming out of all these like one-liners. But it's such a concise performance. It's just like Madlib on the decks. He's just like spazzing over his beats, and that's it. And it's just like, you just transfix the entire time. And that's like the true essence of an MC and like producer dynamic. Just like,
that's it, man.
Perfect marriage, man. Perfect.
That's it, bro. There's chemistry. Chemistry goes a long way. Like, chemistry is going to carry 60% of the album, like the, mm-hmm. or the song, whatever it is. Because like, if you've got chemistry, everything pops and starts moving real easily, you know?
Yeah,
and it shows in the music. You can feel it.
Mm. Who else? Obviously Madlib being one of them, because I think you speak to most producers and they'll just say, yeah, I'm influenced a little bit by Madlib, or you know, who would you say your biggest influences were as hip hop producers? I know besides the kind of cross genre stuff, but from
no. I'll leave the cross genre stuff. I will do that. Yeah, I won't get back to you, right? But I'll start it off from early. Because you know, like I it changed for me as things went along. But like generally, it was East Coast shit that was my thing. You know, like the obvious ones, the early ones, that you know, Pete Rocks, Large Professors, Primos, yeah. Like, and solely because my favorite album growing up was Illmatic, you know, so like the beats off of there, the people that produced the beats off of there is the people that like was the people I was trying to emulate when I first started making beats, you know, like Mobb Deep, like Havoc, whatever, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah. It's weird though, isn't it? Because it's like, you know, hip hop, especially like in the, like UK hip hop, going back to that term, is very like boom bap in aesthetic and sound. Let's forgetting about all the kind of offshoots and how that's evolving. But at the time in New York, that's like, it sounded that way because it was all that was available to them. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah.
Do you know what I mean? So it's kind of like naturally you would think that it would evolve and progress, which it did in America. So reverting back to that sound is obviously shrouded in kind of nostalgia, and I get it because I love it, man. I mean, I'm a sucker for boom bap, but
yeah, man.
At the same time, like, I love hearing different hybrids of different bits and bobs and stuff.
So
sorry, man, I cut you off. But so after the kind of East Coast stuff from the 90s, who did you move on to then?
Obviously, like, when I started making beats then, people like Lewis Parker, Harry Love.
Across the pond, back to the UK, man.
Yeah. This is what I'm saying, because obviously once I started making boom bap, was a kind of around the times, like I'm saying, it's like 2002 2003, and that's around the times that the sound in America started to change in a big way.
Yeah,
do you know what I'm saying? So like I was listening more to what was going on here. Obviously Low Life Records was the main thing that was happening, so that was the main people that I listened to. There was X amount of people that, you know, people like Second Son that were doing stuff as well, because I think he did that Turn It Up to the Red, didn't it? The Jess tune, I think it's that tune. But that's one of my favorite beats ever, and tunes, to be honest, but like it's one of my favorite beats, and it's not mad complicated. Like it's a proper boom bap beat, like, you know what I mean? But it sounds dope.
Yeah, man. So I mean, like Low Life was essentially like the precursor for High Focus, I guess. You know, it was like in a way.
I think it was the precursor for everything, bro. Like, because if you look at Low Life, they had like people like flipping Maestro. They had people like flipping. Obviously, what they called Task Force. Flipping, Jest, obviously, Brain Tax. It was a very, like, even them four alone, they're not very similar acts,
I hear what you're saying. I guess that's before, like, grime really took off and went off in its own trajectory, and it was all almost like interchangeable.
Well, that's what I'm saying. They were running
in parallel.
Even on the radio. That's what I'm saying. One Extra used to fuck with UK hip hop because you know Rodney P was still making music. Flipping Ty or Ty, I'm not sure how you pronounce it. R.I.P. to the God. You know, even people like Black Twang having commercial success was low key good for the UK hip hop scene. Oh, UK, there I go again. Let's call it British born hip hop then.
That's the thing. I mean, it's when you're referring to it as UK hip hop, it's you just go to those artists. Do you know what I'm saying?
That's
what you associate it with. I'm not saying it's like right or wrong to kind of like define these artists by that term, but I guess by definition, bro, like, at the time it was very new in the UK. Do you know what I mean? In terms of emulating the style from the States.
Do you remember that, like, For Life Cypher were on the Brit Awards?
Man, I heard they were, but I don't remember it.
This is what I'm saying. When I'm telling you,
that's madness,
like, UK hip hop or rap, whatever you want to call it, was parallel with grime in terms of importance, because there was people, there was people at One Extra. I keep saying One Extra because it's beyond, it's an institution, because it belongs to the BBC. It's an international institution, right? So it's a huge vehicle. Back then, they ran parallel, like UK rap. There was things like Fallacy and Fusion, like I'm saying, Black Twang, all of these people. They weren't really seen as commercial either. They were seen as like not for want of a better word, street. There was a representation for what we were doing in not so much the mainstream, but within a vehicle that was taking it worldwide. And
they laid the foundation, ultimately.
Yeah,
you know,
bro,
I mean,
that's what I'm saying. That's why I always, whenever like a mad debate comes up, I pop up online. That's one of my facts I love to chuck out there about Cyphilly and them, man. that was one of my fondest like memories of UK rap music back then, was seeing them, man, on stage at the Brit Awards in them days, bro. It was crazy. It was crazy, and it was with the Gorillaz, I'm pretty sure.
Matt, that's even like, I mean, Gorillaz are obviously still huge now.
Bro,
David Albarn, they're just like...
Well, it was a super group in the beginning. Obviously, it was made up of like huge, huge international stars. So for them to be aware of For Life Cypher to the point where they want to work with them, pap.
Man, that's actually mad thinking about it.
Yeah, Bernie,
like Skinny Man as well, obviously, like everyone knows.
Huge success, yeah.
Like all the big grime guys know Skinny Man, do you know what I mean?
Yeah.
It's back in the day where it was kind of, you know, it wasn't grime and it wasn't UK hip hop. It was just, as I said, just a
just all rap. And it was just rap, yeah.
Went in two different trajectories, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
And obviously, like, one probably, like, grime, I guess, because it was more of a kind of the UK. It was a UK-defined sound, you know what I mean? It originated in the UK. Obviously, it was a spin-off from hip-hop, but ultimately the whole... like the style, like grime bars, like everything about it.
Yeah. It was intrinsically British.
Exactly, yeah? Man.
Because, you know, like Birmingham, Manchester, London, Leeds, everywhere had their own sound. Bristol, people like Bugsy, them, man, you know.
Bugsy's sick, man. I remember first hearing him, it's like Skippy Flow and that. But did you fuck with grime back in the day? Or do you
a little bit, you know, like... the whole Demo or Us thing, you know, like basically I met Daddy back when he was like 16, 17, yeah. Basically my brethren, Confusion, Hold Tight Jimmy. He met Matt at some like cypher thing, and brought him to me. This is after like maybe like a year or so after I'd done and dropped Gotham Chronicles in Briss. And he showed like he brought Matt to me. And Matt was a grime MC. He didn't even make or rap that much hip hop, yeah.
Mm-hmm.
But what he had done at age 14, he'd written this song called Sinead, yeah. And I ended up linking him up with Chris Lucas to make a video and an actual fucking track and song about it. But yeah, boom. We made Decaying Grammar off the back of that, like that mm-hmm. little thing that's on Bandcamp, yeah. And there's a lot of 140-ish stuff on there. But at the same time, we made a project called On It, which was Dat Kid and Confusion, and it was all 140. I'm pretty sure maybe one or two rap tunes, but not really. And that was all grime-ish, grime-esque. But yeah, other than that, I wouldn't call myself a grime artist. I've dabbled. I know plenty of people in the scene and all that, but I'm a hip hop guy.
Yeah. I feel you, man. I think I know obviously like Teeth Ledge is very like hip hop, you know, very like traditional kind of hip hop sounding, but it just works real well, man. Like your production, Daddy, just again, man. We talked about Freddie and Madlib. It's that chemistry, do you know what I mean?
Yeah, man, it just works. Well, you know what, surprisingly enough, we've got a little EP I'm just about to send it off for mix and master. Six tracks. It's there's some fire on there, man. Something to look forward to, but we're gonna be working on something real special real soon. Well, I say real soon, as soon as all this is died down and then people can go outside.
Yeah,
we're gonna be working on something again.
Yeah, man. Do you think that obviously being in isolation, it's kind of forcing creative types to be more like inventive with like visual media? You know, like videos are obviously like a big thing. And I know that like, say like the 4 Hours album just dropped and a lot of their videos so far have mostly been like animation. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah.
Have you considered
doing... paid someone to do one.
There you go, man. There you go. Yeah. Animators must be loving it right now.
100%, man. And you know the maddest thing, yeah? What you don't realize until someone who doesn't make hip hop tells you that, like, you get a lot more traction out in the real world with videos that aren't just you rapping at the camera now. More credible, like sort of art type hubs.
Yeah.
Take a look and you know what I'm saying, like it just opens shit up to you and makes things easier as well.
Yeah, and I guess it's just having those kind of contacts and, you know, it's very collaborative and you know, knowing someone in like the creative community, you can be like, all right, yeah, I've used that guy before, he was dope, like, and just working together,
it will kind of is it man, like I me personally, I saw someone I posted about it and no one hit, well, bare people hit me up, nothing really happened, da 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 da. And then this guy hit me up, but it was in my request folder. And then I went to my request folder, hit the link, hit the thing. I was like, yeah, what are you saying? Can you send me some of your work? He sent me through his work, and one of the vids he'd done was for my brethren. And I was like, oh, it's you. I'm like, okay, I like your shit already. And he's like, yeah, cool. And I'm like, cool. I'll send you, I can't send you the individual track that I want you to do.
Yeah.
Cause I've got it in the drive and it's the whole album. So I'm going to send you the whole album, but I'll tell you the two tracks that I maybe want to do. I sent him through and he's like, yo, I just listened to the whole album. Fucking shit sick. I don't know which one. I was like, yo, but he's ill. I like, basically, that's going to be coming out. I'm not going to say his name. I'm not going to do any of that. Just leave the suspense.
Yeah,
I'm looking forward to that.
You've got to keep the people waiting. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah, man. Yeah, man. I mean, that's even why I did the vid for the outro, the intro, to be honest. I didn't even want it. Like, basically, I'd already shot one vid in December, yeah? And I wanted three vids. And obviously, this whole lockdown thing happened. And then I thought, oh, fuck, like, what am I going to do? And I couldn't really afford to get two animated vids done. Yeah. So I thought, how can I do the other one? And I got, like, basically the guy that does stuff for our Deadweight shit, this guy called Max Keelan or Max Pierce. And I just got him because he does, like, really mad trippy video shit. And I just thought, you know what? I'm going to film some shit on my iPhone with me wearing some dumb shit and give it to him. And I'll just do it for the intro, because then it's not like a big job. And it's just it's a nice way to warm people up for what's about to happen.
Yeah, man, definitely. I think that's probably the best way to play it. But with Axel Holy, like, the persona, is there like... What is he like as a person, man? What's his kind of what's his personality like? Are we gonna have to wait and see for the project to drop?
To be honest, the intro is not really like, and even what you've heard before, like, it's what you've heard before is all me featuring on stuff, realistically, yeah. Whereas this, even the intro is not really a full picture of what type of stuff I'm talking about on there. And what type of songs that are even on there? You know, there's songs, like, it's not just dope beats and dope bars, like,
yeah, yeah,
songs. So yeah, like I'm saying, it's a sneak peek into who he is, but the album that I'm dropping next year is him, is the full unearthed me.
A grown
ass man album, basically. A very honest, a very open look at, you know, personal things as well, you know.
Awesome, man. I really, really rate that. Looking forward to hearing it. But before we wrap up, man, so if you could work with any artist, dead or alive, who would it be and why?
Dead, I'd say Prince.
That's a good answer, man.
In a heartbeat.
That's a good answer.
Yeah, when I was, I probably would have been around, I don't know, maybe 8 or 9. But my mum and my sister's dad took me to see Prince, innit, at Wembley Arena in London. And it's one of the things that has stuck with me. Like, just walking into the arena, obviously a sea of people, and this little dude, like, all the way fucking hundreds of feet down, just tearing it up. Like, I obviously my mum and them used to play his music in the yard all the time growing up. Man. So that's the one who's not with us no more. And in terms of people that's alive, I don't know, maybe. Who's dope, like, because I'd want it to be someone super dope, like, where there's no way I'm ever going to get that in my life. Maybe Royce da 5'9", to be honest with you, bro.
Oh, shit, okay.
Just because, like, he's been around for time, and, like, everything's, like, clicked for him in the past however many years, and I think making music with him right now would be amazing. It would just be something that just...
Do you know who I thought you might have gone to? And I don't know whether it is a reference to his Funk Flex freestyle, but it's pre-Kardashian Kanye. And it's
Black Thought as well. But just because, like, in my opinion, like, he's another one of them guys where it's like... Not even because he's just been good all the way through, and now he's just like Super Saiyan. Like,
he just transcends, like, rappers, in my opinion, man.
It's beyond that, isn't it? It's beyond that. Did you see his tiny desk the other day?
Oh, mate, he's ridiculous.
He's just sat there.
Yeah.
And then he's like,
Buzz. No emotion.
It's even when, you know, when he did like the, I think it was on Sway, when it was him and Meth on there, and like, Meth Man was like, reading off his phone and that, and which is fair enough, because he still had
buzz, but
just Black Thoughts there, just kind of like spitting real casually. And then just Elijah Woods there, like filming the whole thing, just like loving it. Fucking hilarious,
yeah,
man.
Of course, man. That's wild though, bro. Like, yeah, them kind of guys, like for me, definitely, because I feel like, but more so Royce, just because I feel like he's just in some mad space in his life and his career right now, where like he's just gold is happening, you know, like. Have you heard his last album?
I preferred the Book of Ryan, if I'm honest, man.
I prefer the Book of Ryan because there's more songs on it, terms of whatever.
I love that joint about his old man, Cocaine, man. I really love that track.
I think Allegory is one of them projects. Like, it's almost like a Griselda project if he was on Griselda. Do you know what I'm saying?
Yeah,
where he's doing
Conway,
he's doing,
and Benny was on it, weren't they?
Where he's just doing stuff for the sake of it. And I fucking love that. You're on Shady Records and you're doing shit for the sake of it. That's dope.
Exactly, man. He's making moves, unlike kind of Joe Budden, I guess. Do you know what I mean? It's kind of like
it's not his time, man. I feel like reality is, we all know Joe Budden can rap, innit? It's not one of them ones where, like, oh yeah, he can't rap.
He's overlooked, man. You know, people jokingly were like, you know, those lists that came out, and obviously lists like that are just complete bollocks anyway, because it's subjective and there's no way you
can quantify that many rappers.
There's no way you can do it. But people were like joking, like, oh, Joe Budden, this, that, and the other. And it's like, obviously, you've never heard Joe Budden rap because he's sick.
And the majority of his music came out in like a kind of whack era for music, in my opinion, most of it was mixtape and not mixed. Like, so, but that's not the point. Yeah. The point is, even in Slaughterhouse, Royce was the GOAT, isn't it? Like, Royce was.
I still love Joel Ortiz.
I rate them all. They're all super rappers, isn't it? But in terms of, like, you know, like a god MC, like was there probably waiting to come out, like in terms of on a level with Black Thought or Elzai, or you know what I'm saying?
Elzai, man, he's one of my, man.
Yeah. Come on, Elmatic's dope, yeah, but like them two. Two Slumville albums, the Detroit Deli and I think it's Trinity or maybe the one after, but he murders that, and it's got some of the fucking craziest beats ever. Like
that joint reunion on Detroit Deli, man, that's deep. I know he's not on that, but like that track.
No, he's on that.
He's on the last verse.
Yeah, because he's the one who's like, I had to rewrite it because
that's what I'm saying.
Elzai is just one of them guys, bruv. Like,
and not many people MC. Like, yeah, exactly. He's like a rapper's rapper. If you know, you know.
But this is what I'm saying, bro. This is like, I'm a rapper to the fullest extent, innit? Like, but like I'm saying, if ever any of this stuff ever comes out, all this older music that I've made, that's the type of rapping that I'm trying to emulate, because that's the type of ages I was at where I was more a rapper.
Now
I'm a producer slash rapper, or a rapper slash producer. I want to make music. I want to make something that people are going to bang in their car. People are going to bang, like, do you know what I mean? At a barbecue, like whatever it needs, like whatever the setting, I'm making music now. In a hip hop format, that's how I feel about it.
I rate that, man. I hope that the Axel Holy project gets like the reception it deserves, man. Because what I've heard so far is sick. But send it over, I'll give it a listen, man.
I'll send it through. Like I'm saying, like in terms of the whole thing, I'm just gonna be happy when it's all out, because it's not really, it's one of them ones, man. I've wanted to make an album and put it out as a rapper for a long time, so
it
was all about that for me. Whether or not it's received the way I think it should be is neither here nor there at the moment, because I know that there's so much more in the plan. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah, this,
so it's one of them ones. As long as the people that already F with my music F with this, then I'm cool with it, man. Like, yeah.
I guess the main thing as well is like you fuck with it. Do you know what I mean? You're like happy, bro, when you put it out.
Differently. Every time, know? I leave the house to go shopping, that's my soundtrack, bruv. I listen to it from beginning to end, and not because I'm like gassed, oh yeah, I'm so good, but because I've made it in such a way where you can listen to it from beginning to end. Yeah, like, because that's what I'm trying to make, is an album rather than,
yeah, that's how an album should be consumed. Yeah. You know what I mean?
Yeah,
and actually,
yeah,
doing,
yeah,
it like Damn, like Kendrick, like you can listen to it start to finish, finish to start.
Now obviously that's the biggest difference of that, is that's a commercial album. Even though Kendrick made it, that's a commercial album.
I fucking phenomenal. Love Kendrick Lamar, man. I know, yeah. Like this is the thing, and
he's one of the best artists that's about. Like,
I hate the mindset of I know so many people and have a conversation like, nah, don't fuck with Kendrick, nah, he's like commercial. I'm like, have you ever listened to his music? He's fucking.
I love TDE, bruv. The Black Panther soundtrack is one of the best albums that's come out in about 10 years.
Yeah, man.
Like, for me, as a rounded piece of music, like
fucking James Blake and everyone on that, man.
It's a phenomenal piece of music, and yeah. I'm saying it because he executive produced the album. Mm-hmm. Like, do you know what I'm saying? He curated the vibes. Yeah, man. He's the one who got James Blake and Georgia Smith. Like, you know what I'm saying? Like,
exactly, man. It's kind of like that album, Damn. Like, some of the, if you're not like a Kendrick fan, or if you're kind of more of a fan of like traditional hip hop, I would recommend anyone just go stick the album on, really take time to digest it, listen to the lyrics, and just kind of really just focus on it rather than dismissing it right away.
If you're a traditional hip hop fan, start at his first album, whatever the fuck it's called. I like, because that, it's just boom bap. It's boom bap. He just doesn't rap like anybody else. That's all it is. That's the, because like, obviously I get it, what you're saying, yeah, but like that's what a lot of people that I speak to, I don't fuck with Kendrick, is too commercial and all that. Mm-hmm. I'm like, all right, go back to the beginning. Even go back to Good Kid, Mad City. Like, just start there. Because like,
that's a classic album, man. I mean, perfect. To Pimp a Butterfly as well. Like,
dope. It's just, I think that's the one I meant. Yeah.
Yeah, man, crazy. but Good Kid, Mad City, that's the one. When I've only seen him live once in Bristol, actually, and it was when he first dropped Good Kid, Mad City. I had a broken leg. It was snowing outside. I was propped up against it, and it just went off. You know, like Backseat Freestyle, just went off.
Yeah,
and I was just there, just like, oh, fuck my life. levels, man. But it was cool seeing him, because it was only like, you know, the Bristol, is it the O2? So it's like quite a relatively small venue for Kendrick. Yeah. Do you know what I mean? Yeah.
Because obviously that's the beginning times, isn't it?
Exactly, man.
You're not getting him in there now. No way.
Yeah, man. But all of the kind of like black hippie stuff, like fucking J-Rock I fuck with as well.
J-Rock's album was amazing. Q's my guy, like Schoolboy Q's my guy.
Schoolboy Q, man.
And then Sir's sick. His album was sick. Reason is sick. That's their two of their newer artists. This is what I'm saying. They started, the foundation is strong, and then the people they're bringing through are stronger. Like, it's dope.
He's not a member of Black Hippie, obviously. He's like his own.
It's TD
artist, but no. I wouldn't talk about him. But are you a fan of Vince Staples at all?
Vince Staples is dope. Like, and he's one of them ones from back then that's still about. Like, mm-hmm. Do you know what I mean? And that speaks volumes, yeah? Because he was obviously, it's like him, Tyler, Mac Miller, Action Bronson, it's that school.
Yeah, because they were all like the freshmen, weren't they? Of what was it?
Late noughties or something.
Yeah.
Or early 2011 or whatever. But yeah, they're all still about.
Smashed it, man.
Load of man that ain't.
Yeah, true that. Exactly, man. Mm. I think it obviously is like, you know, a lot of rap that comes out now, it's just not for me. I don't like shit on it. If it's, you know, the kind of like mumble stuff, some of it's all right. You know, some of it I vibe to. It's not something I necessarily like gravitate towards, but you can kind of respect it to a certain extent, as long as it's made with like integrity.
Have you heard of Boogie?
Yeah, man. Yeah, I heard a boogie.
Yeah,
He was still on
Shady.
Shady, yeah.
I rate him, one of the new artists that I rate. I think he's dope, man. I think he's got a good blend of like actual bars, like barring.
Yeah.
And a really good ear for like instrumentals and stuff, man. Like, dope.
Another one's JID. He's got kind of like a Kendrick sound to him. But
I think he's still a little way off finding who he is. Because his music is still very just beats and bars at the minute. Do you know what I mean? Like, they're bangers, but there's not a lot of correlation. And like you're saying, he's Kendrick-ish.
Yeah.
But listen to early Kendrick, he sounds like Pusha T.
Exactly, man. Everything's derived from something else, and it's just finding your feet.
Finding themselves. Throwing. That's all it'll be. Then once JID finds himself, that shit will pop. Because exactly, he's talented, man. Very talented.
Right, man. Just conscious of time and that, Bailey's, man. It's been an absolute pleasure. Thanks for joining me for a chat on the podcast today during lockdown,
all
man.
All good, brother. All good.
Before we sign off, is there anything you want to plug? Is there anyone you want to shout out?
Yeah. I'm going to plug a few things. Obviously, my album, Wonderworld by Axel Holy. That should be dropping end of May. So keep an eye out for that. In the next sort of week or so, I'm not sure when this is dropping, but so this would be like maybe early May or end of April. I got a single dropping on Potent Funk, that's Opus and Deadweight, and it's called Indigo. Other than that, I just want to plug social distancing, man. Just real everybody talk, stay safe out there. The devil is a liar.
Listen to the man. No, man, Bailey, once again, man, respect for coming on. Really, really kind of rate what you're doing. Really gassed to hear the new project, man. So, big up. Thank you again. Where can people find your music and where can people find you on socials, man?
You can find my music all over Spotify. Bailey's Brown, if you just type in Bailey's Brown, all that stuff will come up. That will even include anything that I produce for people where they put me in the name, if they're smart. And obviously just Deadweight, and the unfortunate thing with Deadweight is you're gonna have to work a little harder to find that. D3DWA or D#DWA, long. I gotta sort all that out, but what else was you asking? My socials, at Pre Kardashian Kanye on Insta, or at B Brown Beats on Twitter. Facebook is there, Bailey's Brown.
Nice one, man. I'll make sure to post the links to your music in the comments in the YouTube video when it drops, man. So, bless. Thanks again for coming on, man. You can find us at Shotgun the Orcs, all digital platforms, YouTube, all the socials, all of that. Just search for us and we'll pop up. But, man, stay safe. Likewise to everyone else listening, stay safe. Big up yourselves. We're all in it together. And
big up, bruv.
Thanks again for your time, man.
No problem, man.
Peace.
Peace.